start, but before I turn the microphone over to Ualbai, let me say a few words just to put things in perspective. So there are several famous problems about automorphisms of polynomial algebras. The most famous is probably the Jacobian conjecture, but there are other famous problems, including the so-called Nagata problem about the existence of non-tame automorphisms. So this problem was solved by Ualbai Umirbaev and Ivan Shestakov back in 2004. Their work was split into two papers, and one of the papers, the one where they actually gave a solution to the Nagata problem, got an award for the best paper published by the American Mathematical Society in 2004. But personally, to me, the other paper where the machinery was developed is in a way more interesting because of one of the results that looks like or resembles like small cancellation property of polynomial algebra in two variables. Agata told us this morning about small cancellation conditions on rings, but those rings were like definitely more rigid than commutative polynomial rings. So commutative rings is the last place where you can expect anything like small cancellation conditions. And yet there is something. So anyway, in general, groups of automorphisms of polynomials or free associative algebras are not understood, except for the case of two-generator algebras. Automorphisms of polynomial algebras in two variables are understood since 1920s. And then in 1970, Makar Limanov proved that the automorphism group of a free associative algebra of rank 2 is isomorphic to the automorphism group of a polynomial algebra in two variables. But that's it. I mean, for higher ranks, neither group automorphisms is understood. And so Ualbai will now tell us something about what there is known about these groups of automorphisms. So, Ualbai.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Volodya. So I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me to give you a talk. It's a pleasure to give you a talk in your seminar. Okay, I'll talk about automorphisms of free algebras. The closest thing here, I'll start from group theory, it's more familiar to you all. So automorphisms of free groups. Let Fn be the free group of rank n with a free set of generators x1, x2, xn. Elementary Nielsen automorphisms ni that sends xi to xi minus 1 and leaves other elements unchanged. And nij sends xi to xi, xj and leaves other elements unchanged. So, Jacob Nielsen in 1924 proved that automorphism group of the free group Fn is generated by elementary Nielsen automorphisms. And moreover, this group is finitely presented. So we relate here two things. We relate this theorem always with Schreier, Nielsen-Schreier theorem, which says subgroups of free groups are free. These theorems are, in fact, equivalent in the case of free algebras. Okay, now one more closer thing here about elementary matrices. Let K be a field and A be a polynomial algebra over K. Denote by EIG, the standard unit matrix. So it is zeros everywhere except IJ, please, where it has unit. So EIJA, it is is here identity matrix plus A times this matrix, standard matrix. So it's called elementary matrix if I is not equal to J. And here, denoted by EMA, the subgroup of SLMA generated by all elementary matrices. So we can call generator problem in this case is subgroup generated by elementary matrices equal to to the group of SLMA. It means every matrix with determinant one is a product of elementary matrices. So in the case of M equal to two, it is not true. In fact, Paul Kohn proved that this matrix over polynomial algebra in two variables, more variables, in fact, it's more than two variables. This matrix is invertible, has determinant one, but it is not a product of elementary matrices. And I forgot to mention, in fact, in the case of order two matrices, there is some amalgamated product structure proves it. Then, in general case, if M greater or equal than three, then Suslim proved that they are equal. It means every matrix here with determinant one is a product of elementary matrices. Now about defining relations between them. So they are called Steinberg relations. There are three relations typical to elementary matrices. And defining relations, so it is Steinberg relations plus some relations K to A are defining relations for elementary matrices. Steinberg relations are here. K to A, it is K to functor of A, and the Quillen proved that K to A is equal to K to for functor of the field. In fact, if K is a finite field, then there is nothing here. There are no additional relations. But if K is infinite, there are some additional relations, in fact. Okay, so I'm going to talk about automorphisms of some algebras. So it's here polynomial algebra, first one of rank N over field K. Then free associative algebras of rank N over K and free Lie algebra. In fact, from these three algebras, the easiest one is polynomial algebras, probably. Everybody knows polynomial algebras, but automorphism group of this algebra is the most difficult, in fact. Here, Lie algebras, it is somehow Lie algebras close to three groups. And I think it should be studied as in the case of three groups too. Okay, I will discuss some results related to this. So I will first discuss some results about polynomial algebras, then short discussion about, shortly I mentioned some results on polynomial, free associative algebras and about Lie algebras, in fact. Okay, the first problem here, the first essential result was obtained in 1942 and 1943, the following. Automorphisms of polynomial algebras in two variables. Let K be a field. And KXY is a polynomial algebra in two variables XV. Then there are two types of automorphisms, elementary automorphisms. So which sends X to alpha X plus J of Y, and Y sends to it. It preserves Y at changes only one coordinate, in fact. So alpha is non-zero number, G is every any polynomial of Y. And the same type, different types, second type, it is just X leaves unchanged, and Y sends to beta Y plus F of X. And Jung van der Kalk proved that every automorphism is a product of elementary automorphisms in this case. So it means, in fact, this means that every automorphism of polynomial algebra in two variables is a chain automorphism. Okay, so I decided in this place to give general definition of elementary automorphisms, how notations and so on. This is a polynomial algebra in n variables, and by phi, we denote the n tuple f1, f2, fn denotes an automorphism which sends xi to fi for all I. And I put here some specific notation, sigma I, I for f. This denotes an automorphism which leaves unchanged x1, x2, xi, and xi plus 1, xn, and sends xi to the following element, alpha xi plus f, where f is a polynomial that does not depend on xi. So it's called elementary automorphism. An automorphism is called tame if it is a product of elementary automorphisms. A non-tame automorphism is called wild. So in fact, it means if automorphism belongs to subgroup generated by elementary automorphisms, it's a tame automorphism. Wild automorphism that does not belong. So it is in fact a subgroup membership problem somehow to define wild and the tame automorphisms. The subgroup of the whole automorphism group generated by all elementary automorphisms, we will denote TAA, so it is tame group, tame automorphisms subgroup. As there are elementary automorphisms, there are also elementary reductions, so I want to mention here them. Suppose you have some automorphism f1, f2, fn, then we define degree of this automorphism. It is a degree, the sum of the degrees of components just. Elementary transformation of n tuple f1, f2, fn changes only one coordinate, for example, in this case it is fi, to the element alpha fi plus j, where g belongs to subalgebra generated by the other elements than fi. So it does not depend on fi. It corresponds to that elementary transformation, elementary automorphism effect. An automorphism, theta, is called elementarily reducible if there exists another automorphism tau such that tau can be obtained by one elementary transformation from theta, and degree of theta less than the degree of tau less than the degree of theta. So it means elementary reducibility. It means by one elementary transformation we can reduce the degree of the automorphisms. In this case, we say it is elementary reducible. So here I just define highest homogeneous part. Polynomial algebra has the following standard grading. A0, A1, AM, where A0 is just a field K. AM is the linear span of monomials in X1, X2, Xn of degree M. So it's a grading of the polynomial algebra. The product of AI, AJ is contained in AI plus J. Every element f can be written in the following form, f0 plus fm, where fi is from ai. So the highest here it is fm, suppose that it is fm is not equal to 0. Then fm is called the highest homogeneous part of the element f, if f non-zero. I formulated here one lemma, it is standard lemma. If you have some system of elements f1, f2, fk from the polynomial algebra, suppose that the highest homogeneous parts are algebraically independent, then it is easy to solve a subalgebra problem in the following sense. If f is contained in the subalgebra generated by elements f1, f2, fk, then the highest homogeneous part of F is contained in the subalgebra generated by the highest homogeneous parts of the elements F1, F2, Fk. This, in fact, for this subalgebra solves subalgebra membership problem, because here it is these highest homogeneous parts are all homogeneous, so you can easily solve this part, then you can reduce the degrees. In fact, This lemma is true not only for polynomial algebras. It is true in the case of associative algebras, and it is true in the case of every homogeneous algebra, in fact. So in the case, if the highest homogeneous paths of elements are algebraically independent, then there is no problem in studying of subalgebras. Two algebraically dependent elements. So I want to mention where difficulties start. Difficulties start from right here. If you consider polynomial algebra one variable, k at x, they consider elements x squared and x cubed. They are algebraically dependent, but x squared is not contained in subalgebra generated by x cubed, and the x cubed is not contained in subalgebra generated by x squared. So here we have one lemma. If two algebra elements of a polynomial algebra, suppose that they are algebraically dependent. If they are algebraically dependent, then there exists element A in this subalgebra, in this algebra A, such that F and the G is contained in subalgebra generated by A. So it means if two elements are algebraically dependent, then they are polynomials in one element A, in fact. Okay, so suppose we have an automorphism of the polynomial algebra in two variables kx, y. And suppose that its degree greater or equal than 3. Here it means if it is equal to 2, then it is an affine automorphism, linear plus some shifting. So it is not interesting. In this case, it is degree f plus g greater or equal than 3. It's a more interesting case. Then in this case, the highest homogeneous paths are algebraically dependent. And what proved Jung and van der Kalk in this case? They proved that in this case, degree of f divides degree of g, or degree, or again, so it says here, it should be degree of g divides degree of a, okay? So this means, in fact, the highest homogeneous path of a is equal to alpha some constant, and the highest homogeneous path of g to the s, or the highest homogeneous path of g is equal to beta f highest homogeneous path to the t. So suppose that f highest homogeneous path is equal to this, then we can make one elementary transformation. So we can change this element f to f minus alpha gs. Then this reduction reduces the degree of theta. So reducing the degrees in this case, thanks to this theorem, reducing this at the end, we get some affine automorphisms. And this solves, this proves that van der Kalk theorem. So it's main point, the degree of f divides degree of g, or degree of g divides degree of a, in fact. So in the case of three variables, many people try to solve this problem. Are they wild automorphisms or are they all tame? So into 1972, Nagata constructs the counterexample, potential counterexample in that case. So it's an automorphism of the polynomial algebra in three variables x, y, z. It is written in this way. But where it come from? So Nagata himself considered this automorphism, sigma, as an automorphism of Kz of polynomial algebra in two variables x, y over Kz. So it is Kz considered as a constant ring, so that every automorphism leaves Kz without changes. In this case, he proved this automorphism is non-tame. But it doesn't mean that if you consider all automorphisms in the case x, y, z, it means it is non-tame too. This is a subgroup of this KZ, if you consider here some ring, then it's a subgroup of this group, where KZ is a field. Over the field, we know all automorphisms. So consider here some three automorphisms. I want to describe a little bit about, I thought always, how Nagata constructed this example, where it come from this example, this easiest example. So here consider the following. Alpha changes X to XZ. This is non-legal, in fact, in the case of rings, but it's legal in the case of the field. Okay, so it is not chain in the case of this field, of this ring. But then this automorphism is absolutely chain automorphism, and this one is absolutely chain automorphism. If you consider alpha, beta, gamma, beta minus one, alpha minus one, then you get exactly that automorphism. What does it mean? So at the beginning, we multiply it by this Z non-legally. And at the end, we divide it by Z, just. And we get that Nagata automorphism. So this automorphism is not elementary reducible. Okay, one more source of automorphisms in polynomial algebras, it comes from locally nipotent derivations. They are called exponential automorphisms. So in fact, there are many locally nipotent derivations in this algebra. So a derivation D of an algebra A is called locally nipotent if for any A, there exists a natural number N, which depends on A, such that if you differentiate N times, you get zero. If D is locally nipotent, then exponent of this derivation is an exponential automorphism, always. So here are some examples of locally nipotent automorphisms. A derivation D of the polynomial algebra is called triangular if dx1 belongs to subalgebra generated by x2 and so on xn. So it does not depend, it does not contain x1, in fact. Derivative of x2, it contained in x2, in subalgebra generated by x2, xn, and derivative of xn minus 1 is contained in subalgebra generated by xn. And the last one, dxn, is just a constant from the field. It is easy to show that every triangular derivation is locally nipotent. It's the main source of locally nipotent derivations. Now, there is a question about locally nipotent derivations. Rentschler proved in 1968 that every locally nipotent derivation of the polynomial algebra in two variables in characteristic zero is triangulable. That is conjugate to a triangular derivation. So conjugate, if you conjugate, conjugate a derivation by an automorphism, then you get again a derivation. So and if it is locally nipotent, then conjugate automorphism is also locally nipotent. So in this case, every locally nipotent derivation is conjugate to a triangular derivation. Then consider the following derivation. D, which sends x to 2y and y to z and z to zero. This is a triangular derivation, and that's why this D is locally nipotent. D is locally nipotent, and this element is contained in the kernel of D, so it is a constant of derivation. If you differentiate this element, you get zero. Okay, then if you multiply that derivation D with this W, you get a new derivation. It is also locally nipotent, in fact. It's always locally nipotent, derivation of this algebra. And Haim and Bass in 1984 proved that this derivation is not triangulable. So it is not conjugate to a triangular derivation. Why I'm mentioning this derivation? Because the exponent of this derivation is again Znagata automorphism, in fact. So Znagata automorphism, it's an exponential automorphism. In 1989, Martha Smith proved that Znagata automorphism is stable tame. Stable tame, it means if you add one variable more, for example, t, and extend that automorphism sending t to t, then this one becomes tame. This one becomes tame. So Martha Smith, in fact, showed that some class of exponential automorphisms, they are stable tame in the case of polynomial algebras and the case of pre-associative algebras too. Okay, so here I come back to estimation of degrees. So in this case, we have to study subalgebras of generated by two elements because we are going to study tame automorphisms. In tame automorphisms, you have to add some element from two generated subalgebra. So for this reason, we have to study tame automorphisms of polynomial algebras in three variables. First, you have to describe subalgebras generated by two elements. As I said, if the highest homogeneous parts of elements algebraically independent, then there is nothing to study there. If one of them is contained in subalgebra generated by the other, then you can reduce this. So it is necessary to study the following case. Let AFB, so it's two elements of this polynomial algebra. We call them reduced pair. If two elements are algebraically independent and the highest homogeneous parts are algebraically dependent. And this FG is not reducible. So it's a third condition. Okay, so suppose we have a pair of star reduced pair of elements of A and the denoted by M, N, it's degree, minimal one, and the maximal one has degree M. So it is P, it is when you divide N by its greatest common divisor. S, M divided by N, M. So it's greatest common divisor of M, N. Estimation, Valodia mentioned about this first paper. So it is exactly this result was proved. If you take a polynomial in two variables, and suppose that the degree of this polynomial with respect to y is equal to k, which can be represented as pq plus r, where r less or equal than p. So it's divided by p, in fact. P is the minimum one. Right? Then degree, when you substitute fg instead of xy, those polynomials, degree becomes equal to this, greater or equal than this number. So it is the main estimation. In fact, I hope that this number, if it contains essentially G, then it should be always greater than M, but it is not true. Greater than maximum of them, but it is not true. So it is take here, R is equal to zero, R is equal to zero. Q is equal to one, then you get this number PM minus M minus N and this one. This is here is per Poisson bracket, in fact, of two elements, but it is at least two. That is at least two. So PM, M minus M, it is one M, PM minus N, it's greater than zero. So it is at least greater than one. For this reason, I formulate here corollary from this theorem. It reduces pay of a star reduced pair of elements FG cannot generate KXY. A star reduced pair of elements FG cannot contain elements of degree one from this estimation. This gives exactly a new proof of the Jung's theorem. By the way, I mentioned the theorem Jung and van der Kalk, and so it is Jung proved in the case of characteristic zero. That is the same theorem. And I forgot to mention here, we prove this estimation in the case of characteristic zero only. Characteristic zero. So even after some time, I understood here it is not only greater than maximum. Sometimes it is greater, less than maximum, and it might be even less than minimum in some cases. But this estimation, in fact, works. So I come back to Nagata automorphism. In 2001, we proved that the Nagata automorphism is wild. For this, what we did? We described, in fact, that every tame automorphism of the polynomial algebra in three variables of degree greater than three, of course, three is just a fine case, admits an elementary reduction or a reduction of types 1, 2, 3, 4. So it means that we classified all reductions, in fact, for tame automorphisms. It was heavily used at estimation, in fact. So what I kind of describe this four reductions in this place, but some corollaries. So to mention here, if you take an automorphism FG, Z, that means Z is preserved, Z goes to Z, in fact. This is exactly the Nagata automorphism case. We prove that it is tame if and only if this matrix, this Jacobian matrix, in fact, if you take a partial derivative with respect to X and Y, with respect to XY, then it is some linear matrix times some product of elementary matrices of order 2. But this is automorphism of order 3 in three variables. Jacobian matrix in general, it has order 3. But in this case, we can consider this matrix for this. Okay, then, so it's somehow related to elementary matrix anyway. Every tame automorphism of degree greater than 3 of the form FGZ, it is again the same case, admits an elementary reduction. So in this case, you don't have to consider reductions of types 1, 2, 3, 4, just elementary reductions. So Nagata automorphism does not admit elementary reduction. That's why it is wild in this case. Okay. So I want to mention here some improvements. In fact, Makar-Limanov and then Van den Essen and Makar-Limanov-Williams, they give alternative proof of the degree estimation for two generated subalgebras. The first part of the paper, in our paper, it was something like 20 pages, but they improved, not too much, but improved the proof. Then Makar-Limanov in 2006 improved the proof again of that estimation for polynomials and with U. And proved an analog of this estimation for free associative algebras. This is not general estimation, it's some related to commutator and so on. But it was proved in the case of free associatives. It's very interesting, in fact. Then Venerov and Kuroda proved an analog of that estimation theorem for K elements. Interesting thing, they improved the proof again. In fact, in this case, it became very short, the proof of the first estimation, in fact, first estimation theorem. By the way, they proved also this estimation for K elements, but it works only in the case of two elements, in fact. The proof was improved. So again, I mentioned there about the reductions of types 1, 2, 3, 4. Type one example was constructed in our paper that to show that there is something except elementary transformations. Okay? One example was constructed. Then Van den Essen and Makar-Limanov and Williams constructed in 2004 new examples of automorphism admitting reduction of type one. Then in 2010, Kuroda proved there is no reduction of type 4. This one, Makarlimov knew also about this when I came here in 2007. So he told me that he knows that, and he suggested to write about this, but we get lazy, and Kuroda has written first about this. So it is there is no reduction of type 4. But except that, about reductions of types 2 and 3, we don't know anything. In fact, there are no examples of reductions of type 2 and 3. They are just hypothetical reductions. Okay, now I want to mention some results.
Sorry, can I ask a question? These results of Veniro and Kuroda, they are also about just two variable case?
No. By the way, you told that that first result was our result was not in the case of two variables, but two polynomials.
Uh-huh.
Two polynomials. This is in the case of n k polynomials. Uh-huh. They proved.
Okay.
About defining relations. So, defining relations, we consider the I denoted as generators, we denoted sigma I alpha f in this general form. In group case, I know it's people tend to find finite number of generators, but related to this field, it is not convenient to find some generator. Generated finite number of generators. There is no finite number of generators, but there are some finite type generators in the defining relations. Their language it's a little bit complicated. I forgot to mention some generators here, but this generator is convenient in the following term. So they satisfy the following three conditions. In fact, it is written in this form. So it is the relation first relation, second relation, and this is third relation. So they are some analogous of Steinberg relations, in fact. So here is just Ks. Ks, it's just automorphism, which sends xk to xs and xs to xk. The first one is standard. The second one, in fact, it doesn't exist in the case of two variables. In the case of two variables, so it means here, f does not contain two variables, right? Then it is f is just constant, so it does not exist. Thanks to this, that does not exist in these relations, the structure of polynomial automorphisms, the group of the group polynomial automorphisms in the case of two variables is very, very good. But this relation two, it hurts, in fact. This is a difficult relation. So now, in 2004, I proved that those three relations are defining relations of the tame automorphism group in the case of three variables with respect to generators sigma alpha I alpha f with respect to the generators. Okay, then. It's some development in this area in the last years. Now I think maybe it is exactly good to study from geometric group theory, these groups. So using this, those defining relations, David Wright in 2015 proved that this group is a generalized amalgamated free product of three subgroups along the intersection. This is a complicated thing. Even you cannot see, you cannot say that it is, if some amalgamated free product along the intersection is given, then you don't know if it is identity group or not even. So it is then, Lemme considered, Lemme has rewritten the whole thing. It's starting from estimation and those reductions, everything. And he created some action of this TM group on a simple connected two-dimensional simple cell complex with a triangle as its fundamental domain. So it is a triangle in this case. It is a complicated case, in fact. But using this description, recently they proved at least some results about that complex. I forgot to mention, I didn't mention some properties of this complex, the hyperbolic and so on, I forgot them. But this group, they proved, is cylindrically hyperbolic in geometric means. So even with this described reductions, we cannot solve many problems in this group. For example, even with this development, we can describe here some finite automorphisms, in fact.
How did they prove that there is a cylindrically hyperbolic based on David Wright's result?
No, based on the Lamy's result. Actually, simply connected. In fact, it is geometrically, algebraically, it's here. Geometrically, it means these results are equivalent to each other. But the action is constructed in this case.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Okay.
So, I will be very short in free associative algebras, automorphism free associative algebras. They proved Makarlimanov in 1970 and Chernikevich in two papers, 1971-72, proved every automorphism of the free associative algebra KXY in two variables is tame. And moreover, they proved that automorphisms of free associative algebras in two variables and the polynomial algebras in two variables, they are isomorphic. So here I mentioned some about some amalgamative product structure. I will mention them later a little bit again. Then in the case of three variables, the same way, there were some potential counter examples. David Anik constructed the following example. So it is even easier in associated case, it's much easier than Anik Nagato automorphism. Delta is described in this way. It's also, in fact, there are many ways to explain where it comes from, but it's also exponential automorphism, and it preserves Z2. Z sends to Z. Okay, I proved that this automorphism is wild too, and I just mentioned final part of that, this proof is the following. In characteristic zero. So I use it, in fact, those defining relations first to pass from polynomial, from associative algebras to polynomial algebras. So it's a moduli polynomial algebras to solve. I use those defining relations. The second part, I prove that, in fact, if you consider this Jacobian matrix of this polynomial automorphism without Z into df dx, df dy. So it becomes this matrix. This is exactly that Kohn's matrix I mentioned at the beginning of the lecture. So this is not a product, this matrix, Jacobian matrix, is not a product of elementary matrix. That's why this Anik automorphism is wild at the end. Okay, so in polynomial case and in associative case, there is nothing done in the case of four or more variables. But in the case of four variables, there are potential candidates. They are the same for polynomial algebras and for free associative algebras. If you take this mapping, if you consider this this endomorphism in polynomial and the free associative case, they are both automorphisms. And it's called Nagata-Anik potential counterexamples in this case. Martha Smith proved for all of them that it is also exponential. For all of them, that the Nagata and the Anik automorphisms are stable tame. If you add one more variable, then it becomes t. So these questions are wide open in the case of errors. There are some conjectures that say maybe it is sufficient to add some exponential automorphisms, so it's exponents of locally independent derivatives. But locally independent derivatives itself are very, very complicated, in fact. So I want to come to this Nielsen-Schreier varieties of algebras. Nielsen-Schreier varieties, so a variety of universal algebra is called Nielsen-Schreier if any subalgebra of a free algebra of this variety is free. So an analog of the classical Nielsen-Schreier theorem holds in this case. What was then? Kurush proved that the variety of all non-associative algebras is Nielsen-Schreier. Then Shirshov proved that varieties of commutative and anti-commutative algebras are Nielsen-Schreier. The most famous between these results is Shirshov and Witt proved that the varieties of all Lie algebra and the P Lie algebras are Nielsen-Schreier. So it is as in the case of groups. So it is Lie algebra, subalgebras of free Lie algebras are free. And Mikhailov and Stern extended these results to the case of Lie superalgebras, Carl Lie superalgebras, and the P Lie superalgebras. So in 1964, Paul Kohn proved that every automorphism of a finitely generated free Lie algebra is tame. Free Lie algebra is tame. Then Lewin proved the following result. In fact, suppose we have a finitely generated algebra of a sum Nielsen-Schreier variety of algebras. If you have F1, F2, Fn are homogeneous elements, M independent, it means they do not generate free subalgebra. And suppose that the degrees is increasing, degrees are increasing, then there is some element, some number I, such that Fi belongs to subalgebra generated by the preceding elements. This one is called sometimes Nielsen property. So it is, as in the case of groups, it works in this case. It is not true in the case of polynomial algebras, you know. So it's in the case Lie algebras, it's true. And by the way, how to work with these algebras, you don't have to know even their definitions. If you know these properties, then you can do work with automorphisms with this, just only with this property. So every, as a corollary, you get every automorphism of finitely generated free algebra of a Nielsen-Schreier variety of algebras is tame. But there are no many Schreier varieties, Nielsen-Schreier varieties. What I did here is the following. So it's if you take any finitely generated free algebra of a Nielsen-Schreier variety algebras, then those relations between defining relations for automorphisms are defining relations in the case of defining relations of the automorphism group, because in this case all automorphisms are tame, in fact. Okay, so at the end I decided to mention some questions about finite subgroups. In the case of groups, you know better than me, so it is, I want to mention here some amalgamated fruit products. Out F2 admits an amalgamated free product structure, but out Fn and out Fn, outer group of automorphisms, do not admit a tree-like structure. So it is it was proved by Bogopolsky if n greater or equals zero. But in group case, there is a well description of finite subgroups. Kuhler, Zimmerman, and Kramtsov, they proved the realization theorem. Any finite subgroup of out Fn and out Fn can be realized as a group of automorphisms of a graph with fundamental group Fn. Now, in the case of polynomial algebras in two variables, we have amalgamated free product structure. It is a group, it's an amalgamated free product of two groups, two subgroups, affine group and triangular group of automorphisms. Triangular group of automorphisms by their intersection. This theorem allows to solve so-called linearization problem for these algebras. Suppose that we have G is a group, amalgamated product of two groups. Then every finite subgroup of G is conjugate to a subgroup of G1 or G2. I don't know whose theorem is it in group theory. So it's Kambayashi using those structures, of course, as a corollary. In fact, he proved every finite group of automorphisms of polynomial algebra is linearizable. It means this group is conjugate to a subgroup of the group of linear automorphisms GL2. Linearizable. Then, in that paper, Kambayashi formulated the following problem, linearization problem of Kambayashi's code. Is it true that every finite group of automorphisms of the polynomial algebra in n variables over n algebraic closed field of characteristic zero, by the way, there should be characteristic zero too, is linearizable? That is conjugate to a subgroup of the linear automorphisms. So it's linearization conjecture means this one. In the case of Lie algebras, so probably I missed that in that case. Okay. In the case of Lie algebras of three variables, that linearization problem for finite subgroup was solved. Then later we understood here it is, in fact, if you take Lie algebras in three variables, then there is again amalgamated product structure, in fact, which solves this linearization problem. But in the case of if n more or equal than four variables, this question is wide open. Might it be studied as in the case of group, or I don't know. So it is wide open problem at the moment. Is every finite order automorphism of a free Lie algebra of rank n linearizable? There are no any counterexamples in this case. Okay, so it is okay. How much time I have? Let's say this is 2 minutes. I will finish then. So I want to mention here some problems. One problem related to exactly tame and white automorphisms. An element of a free of the free group Fn is called primitive, or in our case, in algebraic case, we call it the coordinate related to affine geometry. So it is if there exists a set of elements F2 Fn such that F and F2 Fn is a free set of generators F Fn. Okay, it's a well-known result that if a factor group of Fn by some normal group, normal subgroup is isomorphic to Fn minus one, then n is a normal subgroup generated by one primitive element. The same result it can be proved for Lie algebras by the same method. It here works at the method that all automorphisms are tame, in fact. So it works in the case of free algebras in the same way. It's true. But in the case of polynomial algebras, it is called embedding problem. And so it's questions, if polynomial algebra factorized by some ideal isomorphic to the polynomial algebra in n minus one variables, then is it true that I is generated by a coordinate? Coordinate means primitive element. Okay, in the case, so it was solved in this here corollary one. If in the case of two variables, it was solved. if you factorize polynomial algebra by some ideal and you get a polynomial algebra in one variable, then I is generated by a coordinate. This is a corollary of a very deep theorem in this case. It's Abhyankar-Mohr-Suzuki theorem, is called. Let K be a field of characteristic zero. Suppose that we have two polynomials in the polynomial algebra in one variable X. And suppose that the subalgebra generated by N, F, and G is equal to the whole algebra. Then degree of F divides degree of G, or degree of G divides degree of F. That means FG is elementary reducible. So by reducing elementary, you can get that coordinate here by elementary transformations. So this embedding problem is still open for all n greater or equal than 3. And the same way it can prove it for free associative algebras, kxy by I. Then I is generated by a coordinate. It's the same proof is good. Then Spielrein and U constructed a counterexample in the case of free associative algebras. If n greater or equal than 3, there exists an ideal of the free associative algebra in n variables, such that factor algebra is isomorphic to the free associative algebra in n minus 1 variables, and I does not contain a coordinate. But the problem is still very difficult in the case of polynomial algebras. It's still open if n greater or equal than 3. And all difficulties here, in many difficulties, there are many famous conjectures in affine algebra. They are all related to this problem mainly. Thank you for your attention. So I'm done. Sorry.
Okay, well, bye. Thank you very much. Are there any questions? And there is nothing known about isomorphism of the automorphism groups of polynomial algebras and free associative algebras for rank greater than 2, right?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, any other questions? All right, then I guess this is it.